stutz, stutz, stutz. You like acid, no? Acid music.
Mm.
Paul brought here his Roland Dramatics TR-606 because he said he have some problem with that. And yeah, it's a pretty nice unit. You know, guys, the TR-606 is less advanced than a TR-808. So on a 606 you cannot find adjustments for the voices, and Pureman 909
or Pureman 808.
Pureman 808. So this is the choice for that, because inside this it's absolutely analog. This unit has some kind of issue, which is really common with the 606 and with the 808 and with the 909 and with, I think, with all Roland unit, is the fucking switches.
Yes.
And the pots and everything. Show me where is the problem.
This button is almost not working. You need to hit it very hard and...
But why especially this button?
I think it was used the most time on the
screen. Ah, because it's on a one beat, so...
So at the bar beginning here.
Uh-huh.
On the fourth bar. And also this unit sometimes jumps back. It's also triggering twice.
Nice. And but I think the pots are...
They're quite okay.
So let's make some noise with it first, no? So... We have now cleared.
This is a bit too fast.
Sorry, but we have to disconnect this puppy now, and we have to turn it to the back, and we have to take out the screws.
Cool.
Ta-da! Look at this. It's full, it's packed, it's jammed. Wow, a lot. Yeah, it's so busy. Guys, I'm telling you, this TR-606 is so jammed inside. A lot of parts inside, look. And this is only one PCB, and we have also the secondary one, which is the control PCB.
Yeah, maybe it pops out. Yeah, it works.
Yeah, look at this.
Look at this.
Guys, this is definitely not a VST instrument. Coils, wires, jump wires. Roland, what you did in the past? You have to take off the buttons, no? Somehow. I hope it come off.
Yes.
Yeah, it's coming off. It's sticky, no? Wow. I have a really bad news for you. It's glued. It's really... Fuck! Now, let's do like... Mm-hmm.
They look almost the same.
Where you order it?
From Moza.
Ah! Nice. So guys, if you want to get original switches for your Roland TR series,
here's the part number.
Here is the part number. The part number is 688. This is a joke, huh? 688, not 606, 688. SKHCBEA010. So this one, what you have to search for it. It's made by Apps, so this is definitely the original, which is made by Apps. I hope all of it working.
No idea, I knew.
One time I repaired one synth which contained I don't know how many switches, and I got a full pack for it. And if you believe or not, from the full pack, 5% of the switches already not worked. So
this is bad.
You know, guys, and I replaced all, and I didn't test it, like, and I pull everything together, I assembled everything together, closed the synth, place back the ports, everything,
yeah,
and then even I cannot start the synth to make some noise.
Oh, this is sticky.
It's really sticky.
Oh, don't want to break.
Yeah, I also don't want it, because it's really old plastic, you know, and I really don't want to... Not so how. Maybe with this. Let's try this one. Yeah, these switches will not survive this operation. Really?
Oh.
Look. So, yeah, thank you, Roland, to glued the buttons into the switch. Look what's happened. So now we just killed one switch, is here. And, sorry for my dirty finger, but I'm still under construction here in the new lab. Okay, guys, I have here a big, big, big trouble with this switch.
Come off.
Now. Ta-da!
Yeah, so this area may be just some kind of dirt.
Cola.
Yeah, cola also.
Beer.
Beer, cola.
Pizza.
Cocaine.
Cocaine, who knows what is inside. Yeah, it has definitely some weird smell, if you smell it. Like, no cocaine. I think we just don't know how to take off. Oh, but now we can have a look inside how this shit is working. So it's contained a bit of pin on the middle, but on the right, on the side, there is also a bit of bumpy. So what it's doing is this two part here, it's pressing down this metal to the side. Make sure the outside of the metal is contacting with the one surface of the switch. And then this metal is like shaped like a concave. And then this plastic is just pressing the middle. So let's have a look what's happened when I press it down. It will go from concave to convex. Look. You see? I think it has to be survived more millions of switching, but unfortunately not.
But now it's about 30 years old or more.
Yeah, so this is now 30 years old. I think if you guys have a problem with this kind of switches, I'm sure you don't have to replace. It's enough if you're really just cleaning out the oxidation, because it cannot be wrong. Nothing can be wrong with that. It's really like, it's really smart. So let's try to remove. Maybe we can see something.
Yeah, it works.
Something under. And maybe we find some.
No, this looks good. No oxidation.
We will find some oxidation. Oh yeah, that is on a side. Yeah, definitely, guys. This switch have a really precise mass engineering work on it. So it's not just a piece of.
Can see it.
Yeah, you can see it's contained a freaking engineering. So how they producing this switch is yeah, look, so on a side here, on a side you can see there is some kind of bevel, let's say like this, and the outside is polished, the inside also polished, but the inside is contained some kind of other kind of metal on a top, like other kind of I don't know what it can be, kind of, I know have cool. I think there is some kind of magic voodoo how this metal part can be from concave to convex with the pressure and how it's connecting. And look here in the switch, you just have this is the input connection, these two, make sure it's always connected to the edge of this metal. And on the middle, I think this is really soft. It's kind of soft metal. So guys, if you have an issue with this kind of switch, maybe you don't have to order at all. You just have to clean it.
Yeah.
Because I see here inside, not on the middle. Middle is quite clean. So the middle one is quite clean. But on the side, I can see here some kind of oxidation. And maybe how you press it, this oxidation area is rotating a bit to this and this, and then of course it's not connecting. So let's check, maybe we can open the problematic one.
this one.
Yeah, so 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is the problematic one. Yeah, little brutal force. So let's check what's going on in the switch which is not working. Okay. Yeah, it's definitely have more dirt on an edge like the other one.
I can see it.
This one is which is still working. You see, it's not too dark, but this one, which is dead, is much more darker, this oxidation. Yeah, I brought this one, now so it's wet. Let's put it here. Check, check, check. And also this one. You need that, And I'm telling you guys, this have a taste and a smell like Christmas.
Like orange cake, maybe?
Yeah, orange cake, Christmas, let's check it. Maybe this will be your future pot here, no?
No, no.
You wanna modify?
No.
With some kind of German orange cakes? Uh-huh. So first we apply some kind of fresh. I'm telling you guys, if you're dealing with through-hole PCBs, you cannot live without that. Let me show you. Move around. Done. Go, move around a bit. And then. Take, move around a bit. So all the solder now is inside in this glass container. And you easily can just screw this one, yeah. Take out, yeah. Couple of time, and put it back, and done. And as you see now, this glass container is absolutely empty. And on this end, if you have something stuck in, then of course the Weller give you also this pin cleaner. Let me guys show you how easy now to pull out this old switch, which is this one. Huh? You just have to come here with the screwdriver. Look. Ta-da! So you done?
Yeah.
Okay.
So now.
So pull it down a bit.
I need to be careful with
this.
Yeah,
careful with this sheet. I know all these old ribbon cables. It's definitely not a ribbon cable anyway. It's just
like a wire.
Yeah, it's a really hard one, and this can be broke easily from the PCB. But by the way, this is always just broken on a PCB. Make sure you cannot replace it, so it's never breaking here. It's always on a PCB. You hear it? Nice up switch. Tick, tick, tick. Okay. I can play all the day with that, I'm telling you. You are not EV book fan if you don't have Fluke 87V multimeter, yeah? By the way, I ordered from him this EV block multimeter. And I think I did some mistake with the order and I never get it.
No?
No.
Maybe it was confiscated by the customs. Now I just want to compare.
Oh, guys, I'm telling you. This is something. 80 watt. 80 watt in this tiny light soldering iron. 80 freaking watt. It's not this cheap Chinese yum. Yeah?
Put all this together. More cake.
To remove the flux is only the alcohol, nothing else. Mm. It's, maybe there is some other special chemical, but this is so cheap, it's like €1 a liter. This is just air. Good. And then
601
from the contact chemi, and this is clear, so this is not contain any kind of fat or oil or whatever, and this is actually for precision cleaning. So I always do like a bit inside and move a bit like this. Then the next one is the 701, which is contain Vaseline. Now this is not Vaseline for sex, eh? Yeah, just a little bit. Make sure it will collect all the dust later on. Yeah, really nice. Yeah, really nice, no? So you see this green body, only this one, this part, this metal part, this is the indentation. So this is what is make this clack, clack, clack. But everything which is the connections is inside, so we don't have to take care of them now. And it's also not make for your problem, huh? Nothing.
No.
Also no problems here.
It's working like...
Da-da! Time for VD40. Just like this. Wow. No, this is only just boots, huh?
No, you forget everything.
Yes. It's working?
It's working.
Nah.
You can just apply here also.
Ah, okay. Bit more volume. Whoa. So then, snare drum. Low tom. I saw this one is some kind of half analog digital sync output.
Yeah, dinsync from.
And order. Also input.
Yes.
What do you think? What's the maximum speed of this?
Maybe 150 BPM.
So the. Okay, I have a bit crazy idea, guys.
Yes.
Yeah, this is the thing. So. Okay, let's start to some mod, eh? Like some mod video. Yeah, time for hacking. So, this is the ground and this one is the signal, yeah? No, this is the tempo of the TR-606. So if I'm coming down, you see, the signal is get longer. And I have to switch, sorry guys. Yeah. Actually, it's really a beautiful signal, I think. So Watch this. So when I'm turn to the beat speed, then more and more signal is generated. And the maximum, so now we are on a maximum, you see, this is the fastest. And on a maximum, we measured 123 hertz.
16 hertz.
So the minimum is 16 hertz and the maximum is 123.
Yes.
Okay, Paul, what do you think?
I think we need to try another maximum.
So, what we will do with that? We will feed into the 606 some kind of other signal from the signal generator. I have here this really crusty Jelly Bean World Cup children playground signal generator, and now I connected here to the TTL output. And now we are on a range of 1 kHz up to, and this is where we can adjust, and you can see if I'm turned down, it's going down to almost zero, let's say 7, 6, 4, something like this. And the maximum, of course, can be 1 kHz. And yeah, so in this state, this is about 1 kHz. And here we have a 5 W for simulate the running pin, the gate. 2.7 volt and the TR-606 start to run. Let's check it again, this voltage. So let's go down to 2.6. Yeah, so 2.7, absolutely TTL level. So you guys, if you wanna deal with TR-606 and with some kind of Raspberry or Android, what is this? Arduino or Smarduino, you have to know the TR-606 is start to run on 2.7 volts. So it's meaning you can feed easily the 3.3 volt easily you can feed in. Let's check also this one on the BPM signal. 500 millivolt, 1 volt, 2 volt. 3 volt.
It's not running?
No. Yeah. Unfortunately, the tempo input, it just can be run on 5 volt. So if you want to deal with 3.3, you need to apply some kind of transistor, which is pulling up to the 5 volt. So yeah. It's really interesting. No, the trigger is going on 2.6. But the tempo is just on just 5 volt. So let's bring it back to the TTL, make sure it gets really nice square signal. And now the frequency is 47 hertz. And let's make some fun, no? What you guess? What's the maximum?
150 hertz.
Okay. This is 100. This is where we reach the original. It's about 127.
127.
Okay, and then turn more. Yeah.
Machine gun.
Yeah. Yeah. We are almost on 200 hertz. Let's more beat. Oh, nice. Look at this. Look this, what is doing? Go more, no? 2, 2, 2. Ah, bring this cable. 2, 3, 2. 2, 4, 4. And yeah, I'm still hearing every note. So 260. And yeah, I think this is the end. So because after it's like everything is falling to the part, so
it gets slower.
Even more slow. Really interesting, guys. If now I'm feeding with higher frequencies what the CPU can work on it, then it gets slower. Yeah. Really interesting. really interesting. So now we are feeding 500 Hz. But actually this we can use it for some feature, no? Because to generate, let's say 1 Hz, mm-hmm. it's really not easy to generate and keep 1 Hz on a stable frequency. But if you feed your TR-606 with some crazy high frequencies, then everything is became slower. So there is a sweet spot about 264 or something like this, and then everything is get slower. Really interesting. And I'm telling you, now here between the 200 and the 600, you have much more wider range to adjust the speed. Look. Yeah, here is the most slower. It's really like puck. Why we played with that breadboard here and with this junky monkey cabling and with this frequency? Because Paul have some kind of really interesting device. So he built one small device which is converting the MIDI into
dinsync.
Into dinsync. And then he can drive this TR-606 with MIDI, but only the tempo, so yes, nothing else. So he cannot trigger the tones and the voices, he cannot trigger that. And the next video is about his dinsync MIDI synchronization PCB, whatever. And then of course we will do some really crazy stuff with this TR-606. By the way, I really like the sound of this device, and now every switch, every pot, everything is working perfectly, really perfectly. I hope I didn't do nothing now with the pattern and with the generator. See you guys in the next video.